We're here at Dream Studio and Media in Warner Robins, where we'll be looking at the kind of waves we perceive as sound. There's a lot of technology that goes into creating a good sound. There's also a lot of physics involved, and that's what we're here to check out in this segment of Physics in Motion on Sound Waves. As you probably know, travels in waves. But there are several types of waves, so let's go over those for a moment. There are mechanical waves and electromagnetic waves. Mechanical waves must have a medium, a solid, liquid, or gas, to travel through. But electromagnetic waves do not. Both kinds of waves can be transverse, but only mechanical waves can be longitudinal or transverse. What we call sound is a mechanical longitudinal wave that creates vibrations in a medium by the movement of energy. Sound waves, like other waves, are propagations of energy that create variations in pressure and travel through a medium. Another aspect of longitudinal waves is that the particles move parallel to the direction of the wave, like this. The slinky vibrates back and forth. But because the vibration of the particles is equal in both directions, the total displacement of the particles affected by the wave is zero. The medium does its job transferring energy, but then goes back to its original position unchanged. This is Cornelius, a music composer here to help us analyze what sound really is and how it works. Our ability to hear sound is an amazing feat that involves a lot of physics. Let's look at what happens when we perceive a longitudinal wave as a sound. In the case of this digital keyboard, Cornelius is doing work on the key when he strikes it, producing mechanical energy that gets converted into electrical energy by the components in the keyboard. The electrical energy is converted into sound energy through the speakers, which makes its way to our ears in the form of sound waves. The waves become mechanical energy again and cause the eardrum to vibrate. The vibrations pass through the eardrum to the middle ear and into the inner ear. That's where the cochlea is located, which has many thousands of cells called hair cells, so-called because they have little tufts on them. The hair cells act as receptors and change the vibrations into electrical energy. Those electrical signals are sent to the brain. The brain, also using electricity, tells you that you are hearing a sound and what that sound is. And the result is... Here's something amazing. You can actually see sound happen. Through a process called Schlieren photography, we can see the actual sound wave. This is not the effect of sound you're looking at, but the sound wave itself moving through the air, creating areas of high and low pressure. Now that you've seen what sound looks like, let's look at the architecture of a longitudinal sound wave. The energy causes variations in pressure that makes molecules band together in some areas, creating areas of high pressure called compressions. We call the low pressure areas of the wave, where the particles are farthest apart, rarefactions. To measure a wavelength, which we do in meters, we measure the distance between two waves that include one full compression and one full rarefaction. We call the number of wavelengths that pass by a given point every second the frequency, which we measure in hertz. So one wavelength in 1 second would have a frequency of 1 hertz. 20 wavelengths in 1 second would have a frequency of 20 hertz. 2,000 compressions would be how many? Of course, 2,000 hertz. Sound waves, like other longitudinal waves, behave in certain ways. When the velocity of the wave is constant, the wavelength and frequency are inversely proportional. That means when you increase one, you decrease the other, like this. The relationship between these variables is the velocity of the wave in meters per second is equal to the frequency in hertz times the wavelength in meters. Now, what about the speed of sound? We often say it travels at 750 miles per hour, but that can actually vary. There are two variables that affect the speed of sound: the medium it's traveling in and the temperature of that medium. Let's talk about how the medium affects speed first, which is the result of the density of the medium. Sound travels the slowest in gases, faster in liquids, and fastest in solids. It's easier for the sound waves to go through solids than through liquids, for example, because the molecules in solids are closer together and can push each other more quickly. It can make a big difference. Your ears receive a sound wave 4 times faster underwater than through the air, because water is more dense. If you've ever noticed that you can't really tell where sound is coming from when you're underwater, it's because the waves are reaching your ears so quickly that your brain can't distinguish where the sound is coming from. So would sound travel faster through air or a metal rod? Right, the metal rod, because it's much more dense. There's another factor about the medium that affects speed. It's elasticity, which is how quickly the molecules bounce back after a wave has moved through them. So, for instance, while a lead rod is more dense than a steel rod, sound travels faster through the steel because the steel is more elastic. The more quickly the molecules in the medium return to its original shape, the more quickly the next pressure wave moves through it. Now, what about temperature? How does that affect the speed of sound? Sound waves travel faster in warm air than cooler air, and here's why. The molecules in warm air are moving much faster than those in cooler air. Because they're zooming around so much, they will vibrate more quickly, which helps transmit the wave faster. So, would you hear a sound more quickly on a hot summer day or hiking in the mountains in the fall? Right, on the hot summer day. So, where did that 750 miles per hour come from? That's about how fast sound travels in dry air at 3.3 degrees Celsius, which is about 38 degrees Fahrenheit. That number will change as the temperature changes. For instance, at room temperature, which is 20 degrees Celsius, sound travels at 343 meters per second, or 768 miles per hour. The speed of sound in air increases by about 0.6 meters per second for every 1 degree Celsius increase in temperature. The equation is the speed of sound in air equals 331 meters per second plus 0.6 times the temperature of the air in Celsius. You've heard about sonic booms, right? When an airplane travels faster than sound, the boom is basically a shockwave created from the change in pressure caused by the object speeding through the air. Did you know this is also a sonic boom, just on a smaller scale? But the end of the whip moves faster than the speed of sound. Okay, one more very cool example of how sound waves affect the medium. There is something called a non-Newtonian fluid, which is a material that gets thicker as you disturb it by doing something like stirring. Like when you add cornstarch to water and heat it. Here's how sound waves make this non-Newtonian medium. I'll call it by its technical name, goop, although most people call it oobleck. The oobleck is placed on some saran wrap on top of the speaker. What you are seeing is sound waves forming. They are passing through the medium with a lot of energy at high intensity. It works best with songs with a lot of bass. That's because bass has a low frequency, and to be heard well is produced at a higher intensity. Remember, we defined frequency earlier in this segment as the number of wavelengths that pass by a given point every second. But how does this translate into what we hear? We humans perceive frequency as pitch. Let's listen to some different frequencies and hear what we mean. Here's a high frequency. Here's a low frequency. Humans can hear frequencies that are roughly between 20 hertz and 20,000 hertz. Sounds with a lower frequency than humans can hear are called infrasonic, and those higher than what we can hear are called ultrasonic. Know what animal has the best hearing? You think dog, maybe? How about a dolphin? Nope, it's actually the moth. It can hear 150 times more frequencies than we can. Another quality of a sound wave is its amplitude, which is a measure of the amount the wave compresses the medium it's traveling through. Higher amplitude waves have more compact compressions, while in lower amplitude waves, the particles in the compressions are less dense. Humans perceive amplitude as the loudness of a sound. Changes made to frequency or amplitude are independent of one another. You can have sounds that have a low frequency and low amplitude, which we'll hear as low and soft. High frequency and high amplitude we hear as high and loud, or other combinations of these characteristics. Amplitude is proportional to the intensity of a sound wave, which is a measure of how powerful the wave is over a given area. We perceive the intensity of the wave as it moves through the medium as the volume of a sound, how loud it is. We measure sound wave intensity in decibels, which tells us the loudness of a wave as we perceive it. Decibels are the logarithmic ratio between the sound wave's highest air pressure, when it's loudest, and the pressure at its lowest and most quiet. A general rule of thumb for loudness is that the power must be increased by about a factor of 10 to sound twice as loud. Cornelius, can you help us out? Give us something at 70 decibels. Okay, can you cut that into 35 decibels? And to give you even more of a sense of what decibels mean in the real world, a normal conversation between two people standing 3 feet apart is about 60 decibels. A subway train coming into the station is 95 decibels, and a loud rock concert can be 115 decibels. You can develop hearing loss from listening to sounds over 90 decibels for a long time, and anything over 125 decibels is literally painful, so we won't try that here. Hear that? That's a simple sound wave that we call a periodic wave, or sine wave, spelled this way. Periodic or sine waves stay the same. There are no changes in their characteristics, like amplitude, frequency, or wavelength. Most real-world sounds are much more complex. They're made up of many periodic waves that combine to make one complex wave. And there's another characteristic of sound. It's called timbre. Timbre is the quality of a sound, what makes one sound different than another. Say a trumpet sound, different from a clarinet sound. Thank you, Cornelius. Different timbres result from the way the sound waves bounce off the inside of the instrument and recombine with the original sound in a process called reverberation. We've learned a lot about sound waves, how to analyze them, what they look like, and how they work. That's it for this segment of Physics in Motion, and we'll see you guys next time.
For more practice problems, lab activities, and note-taking guides, check out the Physics in Motion Toolkit.